أتاني مرة نزق ليسألني بما دنت فقلت له أنا رجل أحب الله يا أنت أتسأل كيف من هاجي أما بالحق آمنت عباد الله إخواني فكن منهم إذا شئت وكن معنا على حذر من التفريق إن صنت.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونعوذ بك من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. I bear witness there's no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last and final messenger. There be no messengers after him. And we also send our blessings and salutations upon Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala ajma'een. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, if it wasn't for the Sahaba, me and you wouldn't have enjoyed this religion. And today that we sit over here and we talk about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wouldn't have been able to do that because they were the ones who preserved the religion and they were the ones who actually sent this religion and brought this religion forward to us. So if you remember, we spoke about one of the richest person in Quraysh, and he was the most noble one, Walid ibn Mughira. And we spoke about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliated him in the Quran. And in Surah Qalam, we spoke about the 9 characteristics Allah spoke about. And every characteristic was known to him, except for the ones that he was an illegitimate child. That was one characteristic that wasn't known to him. And he went to his mother and he said, and he asked his mother that, is that right? And then the mother told the whole story. So we remember anyone who goes on war with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be humiliated. And there'll be no respite for such an individual. So now, no matter what these people do, the da'wah gets stronger and stronger. And no matter where they come in, they put these efforts in, this da'wah keeps on carrying on and it flourishes. One of the incidents that comes to mind, and I said I am going to mention this later on, but this was for my talk last week. It was when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was doing tawaf and the Quraysh was getting angry. So when he came and they said something to him in the first round, he came around again. In the second round, they said another thing. They started belittling him. In the third round, they again started calling him names. And then when he came for the third round, he actually got angry, and this time he answered back. And this time he said, يا معشرة القرآش تسمعون والذي نفس محمد بيده لقد جئتم بزبح. So basically he said, oh people of Quraysh, be mindful and listen to me carefully. يستمعون that والذي محمد بيده. So whoever in the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whose hands my soul is, your disgrace is very close. Bizibhin, or your destruction or your disgrace, or you're going to be destroyed, that time is very close. And it's indeed coming very close to you. Now these people actually got very angry and they said to themselves, you know what, this is not the time. And they also got scared at the same time, and they said to Muhammad, we have nothing against you, you go your way, we don't want to trouble you. You know, well, by the way, we're all from Quraysh, you do what you like to do. But then, because it happened in Kaaba, the next day they said, if we carry on being nice to Muhammad, people will start thinking that maybe Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the right person and we should also follow him. So the next day they said, when he comes around again to Kaaba, we are going to hold him and we'll try to hit him and humiliate him. And this is what happens. So when he comes around, they all gather around him and they come and they're about to attack him. Fatima is a little kid at that time, radiallahu anha. She runs for help and she finds Abu Bakr Siddiq. And Abu Bakr Siddiq comes out and he starts pushing everyone away from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he says this amazing statement: "Ataqtuluna rajulun an yaqula Rabbi Allah, waqad ja'akum bil bayyinat, and waqad ja'akum bil bayyinat Rabbukum." So basically, what he's saying: do you kill or do you harm someone who tells you about Allah subhanahu wa taala? Also, this is an ayah from Quran as well. So, and then he says, وَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ رَبِّكُمْ, and he is the one who brings clear signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you, and you want to harm him. And so at this point in time, Quraysh just backs off, but they are angry for what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is doing, and they cannot take this anymore. Now moving on, because they cannot take it anymore, and this is carries on for a little while. Now they are talking amongst each other and they want to change their approach. Because they, if you remember, they've tried Utbah ibn Walid, they've tried Al-Walid ibn Mughira, they've tried going to the uncle as well. Nothing's worked out. Now they want to compromise. And they think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with this compromise, Allah will listen, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will listen to them and he'll be happy with this compromise. So they decide, they think, they say, you know what, we have to stop this da'wah somehow. So in order to do that, we've tried many means. The only way we can stop this da'wah now is we need to go and we need to bring, a proposition to him. Something, we need to give him something in order to take something from him. So they go to him and they all gather and they say, look, we don't want to fight you anymore. We want to give you a proposition. And our proposition to you is, we worship your God one day and you worship our God one day. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says no to that. Now what they're trying to do is, they're trying to be giving him something, and at the same time they're using this strategy that he will also accept their proposal and he will agree to this. But Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam outright says that there is no way I will worship your God. And then they think, you know what, we should actually raise the bar. So they say, why not we worship your God for 1 week and you only worship our gods for one day. And he said, no, that's not going to happen as well. I will never do that. Now they think, you know what, they're about to give him something which is grand and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will accept it. So they say, all right, we've got another proposal for you. We want to worship your God for 1 month and you only worship our God for one day. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, no way that I will ever worship your God even for a day. Now they are talking amongst each other and they say, one of them stands up and say, all right, this is a final offer for you, that we will worship your God for 1 year. And after the year finishes, you worship our gods only for one day. And at that point in time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this surah. You all know this surah. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُوا مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to these guys that they're the ones who have come to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they have laid a proposal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the surah, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. O Muhammad, say to these guys who are the kafirun, and the kafirun are, Abu Jahl, As ibn Wa'il, Utbah ibn Walid, Walid ibn Mughira, all these Qurayshis, the ones who are, you know, against Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they saying to them that I will, to the disbelievers, that I believe in the oneness of Allah, that I believe this Allah is the creator of everything, and I believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one to be worshipped, and not your gods, which are Lat and Uzza and Manat and all these other gods that you worship. And he says, La a'budu ma ta'budun. I worship not which you worship. So basically, I worship Allah and you worship your gods, and I will never worship them. And then he says, وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدْ. Nor will you worship which I worship. So I have been telling you about this religion for so many days, and you have not budged, and you will never worship what I worship. And then he says that, وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ. And I shall not worship what you worship, and what you've been worshipping, which is these gods, and that the Quraysh has been worshipping, which is Lat and Manat and Uzza and all these other gods. And again, Allah repeats, so whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts emphasis, Allah wants to put a full stop on all this. So that's why the verse is coming back again. وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. So he's repeating that. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that nor will you worship that I worship. Because he knows, Allah knows these tyrants. Now, look at the miracle of Quran. We remember, if you going back to some of the lessons we spoke about, Tabbat Yada Abi. That was a surah in Quran. Abu Lahab just had to accept Islam and to prove Quran is wrong. He stayed alive for all that time and he never became Muslim. This is a miracle. That's Quran. See, when someone says you are a liar, and you may change your habits and try to fix yourself, Allah is already saying this man's going to hellfire. He could have just become Muslim. The only thing which was preventing him from not going to hellfire was to become a Muslim. It was a walking miracle of Allah that he lived after that many years. This is the first year of Risala. Uhud happened in the 14th year of Risala. One, that's 14 years after he died. Sorry, Badr. He died after Badr. He did not die in Badr. He did not participate because he already had died. His death was a very brutal death. His body started rotting. Even his sons would not carry to bury him. That was the humiliation Allah gave to his uncle. So that was a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah is putting emphasis that you will never worship what we worship. لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. To you is your religion and to me is my religion. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here. Now I want to give you something very quickly. I like to give lessons. There are young ones over here. You know, you need to understand there are many forms of shirk. One of the forms of shirk is an easy one, which is associating partners with Allah, which we were seeing. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala says there are five forms of shirk. One is arguing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you know, when you argue about the qadr, when something happens to you and you say, why me, Allah? You know, often we fall in this trap. And when someone, if a family member passes away or anything happens of something that we may not like, we always complain, why me, Allah? I've been praying 5 times a day. I know many people who do not do that. That is also a form of shirk. Why? Because you're not happy with the amr of Allah. You're not happy with the command of Allah. And then he mentions there's another sin, which is swearing. You know, taking an oath. Not swearing, you know, the words that we use, expletives. Not those words. Swearing in terms of when we say, Uqsam Billah, or, you know, God, most of the crowd today is Pakistani. And, you know, when we say, we swear, Qasme, we say swearing upon on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is fine. But once we start saying that I swear upon my mother, I swear upon my father, I swear upon my daughter. You know, sometimes people think we're lying. And at times we say, you know, the kids say, "Main migi kasam karo." Like, you know, I swear upon my mother, I haven't done that. That's actually a form of shirk. That's shirk because you've associated Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that oath. Oath is only for Allah. You can only take oath by the name of Allah, nothing else. If you take oath by anyone, that is a form of shirk you've committed. Because all power belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, the other thing is giving charity for praise. Now there is a hadith as well, which is about three people that they will go into hellfire first. And these people are the ones who are Muslims in the world. What are those three people? The one who dies for the sake of Allah. Why? Because he did not die for the sake of Allah. Allah will say you were showing off so people could call you courageous. So people could say you're a courageous person. And the other person is the one who reads Quran and the one who's an alim, who has knowledge. Allah will put those ones into hellfire first. And why? Because Allah will say you only were looking for the praises of the human. You never were looking for the praise. All this best recitation that you were doing so people could say, MashaAllah, what a nice voice you have. MashaAllah, what a great bayan you did. And all those likes. And the third kind of people is the one who was rich and charitable. Every time he was doing charity, why? Because people would mention him. MashaAllah, look at this person, he's so charitable. That is also a form of shirk. That you're looking for a pleasure or you're looking for praises from people. And then the other one is extreme admiration. You know when you admire people extremely and you start following their ways, and the kids can relate to this, and when you have these football stars and you have these pop stars and the music stars and all these stars and you start admiring these people, and you like to be like them, you wear clothes like them, you start becoming like them. That also is a form of shirk, extreme admiration. You should only admire the Prophet, to be like them, admire the Sunnah, and to follow the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the kids actually fall into this category unknowingly. We fall into these categories. We knowingly don't do it, but we don't know, we don't have any knowledge. For example, you know, the kids love football. You know, there's stars, football stars, there's Messi and Ronaldo, and they have got a particular hairstyle. They start having the hairstyle like that. They want to be like them. So this is called extreme admiration. So you start admiring people like that. And then associating Allah's will to his people. This is a very common one that's found in the community. Whenever you say to people, you know, for example, you say, oh, it could not have been possible without you. Or even if you rephrase it and you say, it could have never been possible without Allah and you. This is also shirk. You know, when we say everything is possible only because of Allah, not any other person. Me and you were just the means. Allah sent us here in the world so we can actually, people could benefit from us. But the real benefit actually comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are those forms of shirk. And then, you know, he carries on saying, and you know, this is another thing for the youngsters to understand. Often you see, and this is a very common thing for the people who are social workers, if we try to compromise the basics and the fundamentals of religion. Remember one thing, kids, never compromise the fundamentals of religion. I'm going to be very explicit, and most of you are grown-ups, except for Fatima who sits at the back. Hopefully she doesn't understand what I'm about to say. But I want to say this because at times it does happen. You know, we've got this LGBT community. We've got nothing against them. But sometimes the youngsters have a lot of sympathy, and they show a lot of sympathy towards their action. We've got nothing against those people. Remember that. Try and understand my thing. I mean, I always say, we've got nothing against people. We do not dislike people. We dislike their actions, what they're doing. It's not in line with Islam. So we do not show sympathy for these movements. So it's not that when the time of plebiscite or any of these things come, we do not put a tick. Why? So we can be well known in the community, or such a great Muslim, he thinks about everyone. Whatever is clear to us, our fundamentals are clear to us in the Quran. They're clear. And we should not be going against the rules of Allah. If Allah says this is an evil action, we stay away from it. We do not show any sympathy. Even if we are social workers. See, help comes from Allah. If we were to harm a person, hadith of Tirmidhi, bring a harm on someone, and no matter what you would do, everyone would gather, you would not be able to harm that person if Allah does not will. If someone wants to harm someone, give a benefit to someone, the whole world came together to give a benefit of Allah. Allah does not want that benefit. That benefit would never come. So we have to understand this. And then another, I'm going to give you an example from the Quran as well. This is also very common in our community, because when we come to these countries, we forget the rules. One of the ayahs of Quran is, لِذِكْرِ مِثْلُ حِذِّ الْأُثْنَيْنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِذِكْرِ مِثْلُ حِذِّ الْأُثْنَيْنِ, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is Allah is talking about mirath over here. You know, inheritance. Allah is saying in this ayah that a boy deserves twice the amount that you give the girl. And there is a wisdom behind it. I don't have time to mention that. But what happens when we come and we look at, we don't want people to think we're backward, we don't have women rights, and we start giving the daughters as what we are going to give our sons. But we need to understand there are some laws of Allah which are there in the Quran which we cannot challenge. We put it the way it is, and we do not challenge them, we do not turn them. So if Allah says that, and there is, we follow that. And you know, mirath is a very, very, three things we never follow anyone in our religion, we will never follow anyone. All right? This is something for the boys and girls, you need to listen to this very carefully. Islam allows us to live in this country, follow every rule of this country, road rules, criminal law, everything. We commit a crime, we do the time, jail and everything. Islam agrees with everything. The only three things Islam does not agree with, that's our laws, we bring our laws, and we do not take anything from anyone else except for what Sharia defines. What are these rules? First one, marrying according to our rules. Second, divorce according to our rules. Third is inheritance according to our rules. Whenever we marry according to the rules of Islam. Whenever a divorce happens, ya'adhu billah, there's a divorce, a lot of divorce that happens in our time in today's communities. And if it does happen, if Allah wills that, in that case we follow our own rules and we don't go to the court where the court dictates. Being a marriage celebrant myself and also a counselor talking to many families, this is a very warped mentality that people have, that they just go to court, because sometimes men also make it difficult for the sisters and they just don't want to give divorce, and they just, you know, they make it difficult, they make the life difficult. So the only way they have, and sometimes the imams are also not doing what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has advised, then to make it easy. And a lot of times there's back and forth, back and forth. We need to understand, if there is domestic violence, again, the woman has been abused, she has been hit, no imam should be telling, go back sister and have patience. This is not right. Islam does not say that. If you know there is clear physical, mental abuse, help that sister to be freed from this tyrant. So do not keep them together and back and forth and back and forth, nothing happens. You're just abusing the laws of Allah. Our Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have never done that. And then comes inheritance, which is another thing, another big one, where we sometimes, you know, cut our family members. Just why? Because we want to favor someone. I want to give you the tip of inheritance, one of the biggest tips I always talk about. Even if you have a son who is not loyal to you, give him the money. You never know why. I'll tell you why. Because if he gets that money from your inheritance or that daughter, they will make more dua for you. Why? Because when you're not around, they'll realize, even I was not good with my parents. When they died, they looked after me at that time. They remembered me. Now it's my time. You never know. This son might turn around and become the best. Or this daughter might turn around and become the best. Like other children would never be. So never bar anyone from their mirath, inheritance, never bar. Don't be angry and say that he never came to when I was sick and I'm not going to give them anything. And Allah has, if your parents are alive, there is a ratio for them as well. If your wife is alive, there's a ratio for that as well. And if the children, men and women, both children are alive, there's a ratio for them as well. I mean, that's not the point over here. But just to mention, our kids are growing up in this society. Don't worry about pleasing anyone, worry about pleasing Allah. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. So we have our own religion, they have their own religion. So we only please Allah. Whenever it comes to fundamentals and the basics of Islam, no matter what happens, we never compromise them. We never. But if it's other things, you know, at times you will be going and talking to people, you'll be going to a church and, you know, you go to a church and talk about Islam to them. That's not compromising the religion. We don't compromise the time of the prayer. Why? I've got a speech. What is my friend going to think that I'll be praying? You know, I'll give you an example of myself. I don't like to toot my horn all the time, but this is something I did. I was invited by the New South Wales Labour Union to speak on candlelight vigil for near Christ Church, which happened. So I was invited, there was no place to pray, and this is right outside Town Hall. So there's time for Asr, when I knew my talk's gonna go over Asr. And so what I did, I just prayed on the stage. I just asked him, can I pray? And he said, you know what, you can pray, well, we don't have any problem. Ask people, when you're at the airport, ask people. Don't just say, you know what, Allah will protect me. No, no. We have etiquettes as well. It's our etiquettes. We're at someone else's place. You're at the airport, go ask the person at the counter. I'm about to pray. Because see, and it's on the camera, I mean, no exaggeration. If you start praying without letting anyone know, the next thing you might know, Asia might surround you and might put you in the van and take you somewhere. Because when people are praying or calling, chanting Allahu Akbar, that's not considered to be right in public. So, you know, avoid the harm. Come, la darar wa la dirar. This is one of the principles of jurisprudence, that we do not harm people and we do not allow harm to come upon us as well. So you do not harm people, and if someone comes to harm you, do not say, oh, you know what, brother, you can punch me. We do not say that. We tell him, if you do that, you guess what? I've also got two hands, so try it. You know, so this is how it is. So now, this is something for the youngsters, the message I wanted to give. And so, no matter, see, they came down to the ratio of 365 days to one. Even then, Rasulullah did not agree to that. So that was a fundamental principle. God is only one. No matter what happens, we will always worship God. Now they're angry, they come around. And so you also remember, these guys, Quran is saying, they start mocking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now. And they start mocking Allah and they start mocking Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now remember, Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. When you would ask them, who created the skies and the land, they will say, لَيَقُولَنَّ اللَّهَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created them. They would say that. See, the only thing in the society was they did not ask Allah for little things. They knew there was a God. And if you remember, if you've been my student from the first class, which I'm going to about to test some people, there was a man who came to Quraysh from the tribe of Khuza'a, and he was the guy who actually brought idol worship. Because he went to Sham, and they did not have water, so they had a god, they had a little idol for water. Who was that guy? Suleiman's just closed his eyes, so he's thinking very deeply. Amr ibn Luhay. He was the leader of Khuza'a and he was the leader of Makkah. So he's a guy, and he brought this idol worship. Prior to that, they all worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because they were on the religion of Ibrahim and Ismail. And so they were following that tradition for many years until this man came and he started the idol worship. So they would say, they knew that Allah is the one who created, but they would still associate partners with him. So they would ask Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mockingly, is your God made out of gold? Is he made out of silver? Is he made out of rubies? What is your God? How does he look like? Do you know its shape? Does it have a shape? We know how our gods look like. We worship them. Do you know? Do you have a figure for your God? Do you know what he is? What does he look like? What does he resemble? And at that point in time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Ikhlas, one of the amazing surahs of Quran, the one third of the Quran. You know, when someone says, and this is amazing, Sheikh Saleh Al-Thameen, he always comes to my mind. They go, and this is ulama. Ulama are amazing. And I say this. Why? Because me and you, we're just normal people. Allah gave me an opportunity and I'm just reading it to you. But the ulama, the levels they have is this next level. The Sheikh Salah Al-Zameen says, we went to someone's house and this was a big sheikh in the town. He had a son and this son was coming around and all the sheikhs, shuyukhs who were sitting there, they were saying, oh look, he must be a hafiz just like his father. He must be a hafiz just like his father. Sheikh Salah Al-Uthaymeen just looked at him and he knew the son was getting shy. And then Sheikh Salah Al-Uthaymeen said, oh yeah, he's the hafiz of 1/3 of the Quran. And he says, don't you know Surah Ikhlas? Read Surah Ikhlas to us. And he started reading Surah Ikhlas and the kid got very happy. And that was 1/3 of the Quran. But I mean, I'm not saying to you guys that we just stop at Surah Ikhlas and be happy with that. But this is what I'm giving an example of. The ulama never let anyone humiliate. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I want to say this on camera, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me a lot of izzah. And subhanallah, no matter how much I thank Allah, I am no way or form to be in a position what I am, and this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today I was in a gathering, there were many scholars who were bigger than me, but you know, I felt humiliated. Why? Because everyone was waiting for me. And I actually came really late, and they all were waiting for me. I had scholars, I mean, these are scholars I've seen, when they gave the mic, they actually didn't give the mic to them. They gave the mic to me to talk. And I'm thinking to myself, Allah, you're testing me with these great people over here. And this is from Allah. See, Allah gives what to izzu man tasha, what to zillu man tasha. Allah gives izzah to whoever He wills. And this is how, when I came to this country, when I was very new, when I came from overseas, when I got married, I actually became the imam of the prisons. And this is the back in the days. I mean, there's a student in there. She sits at the back, Amna. And I used to teach a Quran. Not many people knew me back then. I used to just work in the prison. And that was, again, a position that I got. And I would say I wasn't really, you know, wasn't ready for that. But I was put on a deep end. And I was servicing over 1,000 Muslim prisoners. And I was giving religious verdict in the prison. And that, again, comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter how much I thank Allah. And this is what it is. If you do what Allah has destined you to do, you will never go wrong. Allah will help you in every way. And this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all the sahabas did. They took the message forward and they were not humiliated even for a single bit. And Allah just, you know, honored them. And that's what one of the other points I'm going to come to, inshallah, that you'll see how Allah honored them. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this surah. Everyone knows this surah, mashallah, in this room. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. So now they're mocking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they ask. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. That tell them, O Muhammad, that Allah is one. There's no partners that you associate these lad, these manads, these uzzas, and all these idols that you have. Over 300 idols that you worship and you do sacrifices. No one. Allah is the one and is the only one that has to be worshipped. Allahu Samad. The word Samad in Arabic is actually what it means is self-sufficient. Someone who's in no need for anything. Someone who actually is the one who everyone is in need of. So me and you were in need of Allah. When we need water, we are in need of Allah. When we need to eat, we're in need of Allah. When we need to wake up from sleep or go to sleep, we're in need of Allah. See, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only stopped one of our body parts or one organ to stop them from working, imagine what will happen to us. Right now, me and you were just sitting there. Imagine if Allah took our eyesight. What's going to happen? Everything's gone. I mean, just imagine. Right now, we're able to see each other. If Allah just took that eyesight, what are we going to do? We're nothing. We're going to be on the disposal of insan, of humans, to take us around. So thank Allah. Allah is the only one who's self-sufficient. If we didn't go to sleep, see, people think you're going to die without eating and drinking. Let me tell you, if you don't go to sleep, you're actually going to die quicker than if you're not eating and if you're not drinking. If you do not go to sleep over 24 hours, your brain does not function. You start making mistakes. If you expand it for another 24 hours, you become paranoid. And if you expand it, if you cannot sleep for the third day, then it will be rest in peace, pretty much. So, if you only, and that's why Allah says, sinatun wala nawm, that Allah does not, sinner actually means like he does not even blink, and he does not even go to sleep. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who's self-sufficient. And these people who are saying that they're the ones who've got the groups, we've got the people, and all these people, they rely on these idols and on their cronies and all these Quraishi, the gangs they have. They're nothing without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, lam yalid wa lam yulad. So he begets not, and nor has he begotten. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no children. And Allah is no one's child as well. So Allah wasn't born. Allah huwa al-awwalu wal-akhir. That's one of the names of Allah. Al-awwal, al-akhir. Allah will always be there, and Allah was always there. So if you know the Aqeedah really well, in the books of Aqeedah, it mentions there was no world, there was nothing, there was a kursi of Allah, and it was on the throne, that throne of Allah, which was on the waters. Everything over here was only water. Then Allah created everything. And a pen was created. From that pen, everything was written down. And that's how everything was created. And so when our brothers from a different faith, and the time that we're coming in, the children sit over here, they've always got this question about Christmas. See, there is nothing authentic about Christmas apart from the discounts you get for shopping. So, I mean, that's the best thing about Christmas. But apart from that, there is nothing authentic. And I will give you just one example. I mean, this is not the life of Jesus. Did you know that Jesus actually died in... He did not die in summer. He did not die in winter. He actually died in summer. Well, I rephrase that. Our Aqeedah as Muslims, he never died. He was lifted with his body and soul alive. He never died. That's our Aqeedah. He's alive with his body and soul. Now people ask, how is that possible? When Rasulullah was taken to Miraj, which was the journey in the heavens, that was with the body and soul. So if Allah can do it for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah can do it for anyone. So why I said died, because it just slipped out of my tongue. Why? Because we were talking about the Christians. They believe that he died in winter, and actually did not die in winter. Australia is warped when it comes to climate, so don't worry about Australia. Right now it's summer over here, but around the world it's winter. And he actually died according, again I'm saying this word, died, but when he was lifted, he was lifted in summer. Because when you look at the narrations, which are mentioned in their own books, it says the vegetation was growing. You could see the vegetation. You could see the trees blossom. So this only happens in summer. It never happens in autumn or winter. And so Christmas is celebrated on the 25th of December. Everywhere in the world, in Europe, in Pakistan, in India, everywhere, it's winter time. Everywhere, in America, all those regions. The region where Jesus was, that's the region of Middle East. That's peak winter time, December. He could have never died in December. Even if they claim that he died, could have never died. I mean, their own narrations are saying he actually died in winter, summer. Yeah, but it was another reason. He was in Australia, but he was not in Australia. And he was in Middle East, so... And that was... So this is one of the arguments they bring forward. But out of all due respect, it's not my job. And you know, when they come to us for why you don't celebrate Christmas, they're not looking for theology. Don't take the Quran out, or you guys are going to hell and this and that. This is never a good dialogue. Just say, look, why we don't celebrate Christmas. The kids who are sitting over here, just say, look, every faith has their own celebration. We're Muslim, we have our own Christmas that comes after Ramadan, and one comes after Hajj. So we celebrate that. And you know, so that's our whole season of celebration. And we respect your celebration, you celebrated, but we're not Christians like you, so that's why we do not celebrate it. Be simple and honest. Don't take the Quran out in theology. They're not looking for theology, trust me. They're looking for a simple answer. Say, you're Christians, we're Muslims, we are different. You believe in Jesus to be the best of the Prophet. We believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be the best of the Prophet. We love Jesus as well. We love Isa as well. But we have our own celebrations, and this is, Christmas is not part of them. But just, you know, if you want to be on the lighter side, you can say, but we definitely love Christmas because of the discounts that we get. So that's the lighter side. And I'm sure Abdullah is listening to that very carefully. Your dad's over here, you're not getting any presents, don't worry. Even if it's Christmas. You look very, you have to smile as well, Abdullah, it's okay. Smiling is all right. Abdullah is a very close student of mine. I've known him for a very long time. And also he takes the name of my son as well. My son's Abdullah as well. And Abdullah knows my son kindergarten. He's very, I mean, I am so amazed. My children are known for to be the quiet one, but this Abdullah that I've had, he decided to jig school. He's only in kindergarten last Friday, and he was taking 7 kids to McDonald's. And they were found in the school parking. So I'm like, don't talk to me, please call my wife. Any correspondence related to my children, you have to call my wife. And my son Abdullah is also out of hands, but I believe this one's not. I know him really well, he's a good kid. So, and then, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. So, and there is none that is equal or comparable to Allah. No one can be equal to Allah, no matter what you do. Even when we start venerating in some of the groups, when we start giving Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a really high status, remember that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a creation of Allah, and no one gets to Allah. And one of the hadith, just to very simply, when the world will come to an end, just before Qiyamah, everything's going to die, Allah will take life of all the angels. Allah will tell Israel who lives, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if Allah does not know. Allah knows everything, but he's asking a question, poses a question on Jibreel. And Jibreel says, Allah, you live, and the angel of death lives and I live. Then Allah will say to angel of death, take the life of Jibreel. Then Allah will say to angel of death, who lives? And angel of death will say, oh Allah, you live, who will ever be living? There will be no, death will never come to you and I live. Then Allah will say to angel of death, take your life. And at that point in time, the narration says, the angel of death will say, if I knew taking life was that painful, I would have never taken any life. And he would die. So Allah will remain. And then Allah will call the tyrants. The hadith says, Aynal Jabbareen. Where are the tyrants? Where are these people who used to think they were the compellers? They would compel, they would oppress people. And then he would say, Aynal Mutakabbireen. Where are the ones who were proud of themselves? They were proud of their cars. They were proud of their houses. They were proud of their status. Where are those people now? So just this is something that happened. And at that point in time, even this did not work after this surah. As ibn Wa'il, you all know As ibn Wa'il. As ibn Wa'il is the man, if you go back some sessions that I did, he was the man who was responsible, who cheated a Yemeni. And when he cheated him, he did not pay his dues. And at that point in time, all the Quraysh gathered together and they put a treaty together. And that treaty was known as Hilful Fudul. And Hilful Fudul was a treaty where no one could take the right of anyone. And the guy who was on the other end of this treaty was As ibn Wa'il. As ibn Wa'il is another tyrant of Mecca, and he's the father of a Sahabi, Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu. And this man says that he gets very angry and he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, "Da'uhu, fa'innama huwa abta." That he says to him, to the people, leave him. Leave him, da'uhu, leave him. فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ عَبْطَ. That this man is cut off. don't you see Allah took his sons, he's got no sons, he's only got daughters, and he's going to be cut off. No one's going to say his name. He's going to die like this. He's never going to be mentioned. And then he says, لَعَاقِبَهُ لَوْ حَلَكَ, that as soon as he dies, he has no children, he has no sons. لَوْعَاقِبَهُ لَوْ حَلَقَ لَنْ قَطَعَ ذِكْرُكَ, and there will be no one to mention his name. There will be no one. He will be like someone who's been forgotten. And at that point in time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this amazing surah. This is an amazing surah, and everyone, the kids actually love this surah. They've memorized the surah. This is the smallest surah of Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals this surah, and he says, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. I think Dawood wants to say it. إِنَّ شَهْنِيَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْطَرُ. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the surah with the glad tiding. إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we've given you kawthar. We've given you a pond in Jannah. And the hadith says, if you make your way to kawthar, if you had a sip from it, you will never be thirsty for the eternity life in Jannah. Never thirsty for the eternity life of Jannah. You will never, never ever want to have anything. That one sip will suffice you. And that's kawthar. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be at that pond, and he will actually be serving, according to one of the narration, which is a weak narration, but he'll be serving that water of Kawthar to people. And then, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. And then, Abdullah, can you switch on the lights? I think it's somewhere there. So, therefore, turn to the prayer of your Lord and sacrifice in the name of your Lord. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that turn to your Lord, to the Lord which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to make zikr of Allah and to sacrifice for the sake of Allah. Inna shaniyaka huwa al-abtar. And then Allah says, for he who hates you, he will be the one who will be cut off. Cut off in prosperity, and cut off in his lineage, and cut off from his name being mentioned in this entire world. Look today, subhanAllah, he had no sons, and me and you will mention his name, and you are gathered here to hear his story. That's why we're gathered here. He was not Abtar. And you know, we've got this mentality as well. This was the mentality of the Arabs as well, that sons were the ones who were going to carry the name. Allah is the one who makes you, renowned, and Allah is the one who makes you popular, and Allah is the one who cuts you off. You know, when you go to Friday sermons, when it says, Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu sallu alayhi sallimu tasliman kathira, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the ayah to us, O you believers, when you hear the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, send salawat to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallimu tasliman kathira. And before that, Allah says, Inna Allah wa malaikatu yusalluna ala nabi. Allah and the malaika are the ones who are sending blessings on Rasulullah. Amazing. Allah does not need to send blessings on anyone. Allah is the one who sends blessing on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all the angels are sending that blessing upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then after addressing that, also وَرَفَعْنَاكَ لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ, another surah that you know, أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ, in that surah Allah mentions وَرَفَعْنَاكَ لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ, that Allah will raise your status, Allah will raise your zikr, Allah will raise your mention, that you'll be mentioned by people, and in so many people around the world today, 1 billion people, if they call themselves Muslim, they unite on one thing, that they all believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No matter what the kind of Muslims, they would be progressive Muslims, or you know, any kind of Muslims, extremist or moderate, they all believe and they all unite on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now, after that, Abu Jahl is now, this is the final point I want to make, and after that We still have about 20 minutes, and then I'm going to go into these tafsir. And I want to give you, I'm not going to give you any tafsir. This is my own tafsirs. But I will tell you which one you can buy. I love my books, but I don't share my books with anyone, even my children. You know, the other day, I was very upset because my daughter went into my office in the house, and my library's got about 2,000 books. And so I've got shelves on all different sides of the wall, except for one side where my table is. But the other three sides, I've only got a shelf which goes up to the ceiling. And so in that, I spend a lot of money to get these books as well. And so she took one of the books out. So I've got a whiteboard. And as a teacher, I love whiteboard. And if you, your sons have studied with me, they can tell you how much I write on the whiteboard. So Suleiman's already laughing. So basically, so she took the marker from the whiteboard and she actually scribbled in one of the very rarest book as a book of Aqeedah. I was very upset and I was very sad as well, but eventually I just wanted to do something to her. But I said, you know what, these are my children. After that, I just brought a latch and I've locked that room and I said, no kid is allowed in this room and no one's gonna go in, because my daughter loves writing and she, ironically, she writes on my books. That's the best place she thinks to write. So now this Fir'aun of Ummah, he is the one, as you all know, Amr ibn Hashim, he comes to the Quraysh and he says, you know what, we are going to do something to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and we don't have to worry about him, and I will go and deal with him. He's done enough damage to us, and one day Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in the Kaaba and he's praying, and then he comes to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he says to him, don't come back tomorrow and don't pray over here. This is our place. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam listens to him and he just leaves, does not say anything. But the next day Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes back. He's not going to be scared by this Fir'aun, and he comes back and he starts praying, and then he gets really angry and he goes to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam right on his face and he says, alam anhakum an hadha, that didn't I forbade you to come and pray in the Kaaba? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gets angry and he replies back to him. He says, who are you to tell me where to come and where to pray? This is also the house of Allah and I can pray wherever I like. And at that point in time, he says, he gets angry, so you're threatening me that you're going to do whatever you like? Don't you know about my group? Don't you know about my people, that I'm going to gather everyone? You don't have anyone. You've got these lowlifes and all these other people that are with you. I know all the leaders, and you want to put up a fight with me? And he threatens Rasulullah and he's trying to show his muscles, and you know, he tries to do that, but Rasulullah does not want to budge in, and he's not going to be scared of this coward. And so at that point in time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals the next ayahs. And now Allah reveals the whole surah of Surah Alaq. Now this whole surah comes down. And so this is the whole surah of Surah Alaq, except for the first five ayahs, is for education and for ilm, for Rasulullah, the first five ayahs. But from the ayah number 6 all the way to 15 is for Abu Jahl. Specifically, Allah is now dealing with Abu Jahl with these verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kalla innal insana layatgha. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, verily man transgresses. So Allah is mentioning over here the transgression of Abu Jahl, that verily he's the one who transgresses. أَرَّعَهُ اسْتَغْنَى, because he considers himself that he's self-sufficient. Allah has given him power, Allah has made him the leader, now he thinks he's self-sufficient. He can do whatever he likes. And then, إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى, and surely to your Lord one day you will return. Allah is saying to Abu Jahl, surely you will return to your Lord, you'll be coming back to your Lord. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى, and have you seen the one who prevents? أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى, So the one who prevents Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from praying in the Kaaba, is the one who prevents him. Abdan idha salla, the slave, whenever he prays to Allah, whenever he's worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's a slave of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you prevent him from doing that. Ara'ayta in kana ala al-huda, have you seen if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah is talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that in kana ala al-huda, perhaps he's on guidance, perhaps we've guided Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and why you don't follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why do you want to show your power? Why do you want to flex your muscles? Aw amara bit-taqwa, he only enjoins piety. He only tells you to be good. He only tells you to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not asking for anything else. Ara'ayta in kadhaba wa tawalla, and have you seen Abu Jahl? Allah mentions him in the Quran. See, this kind of tafsir is called tafsir al-ishara. Ishara, giving a direction. And we only get these directions how? We get these directions from either Rasulullah's interpretation or from the Sahaba's interpretation. We cannot get this ishara from the Tabi'een as well. Why? Because the Tabi'een would have never known why these ayahs came down. They went back to the source, which was Abdullah ibn Abbas and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and these were the Sahabis who interpreted the Quran. And also Abu Bakr Siddiq and Umar and Ali radiallahu anh, they're from the interpreters of tafsir. So now he's saying, أَرَأَيْتَ إِن كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى, that he is the one who denies the truth which is given in the form of Quran and the truth which is sent to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he turns away. And that's what these guys are doing, they're turning away and they are making it difficult for this da'wah. أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى, know he's not Allah, that know that Allah watches everything. بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى, Allah is the one, he watches everything, and he's God, he knows what is happening, and he will come and for the refuge of his prophet, he will come to suffice that. كَلَّا لَإِنْ لَمْ يَنْتَهِ لَنَسْفَعًا بِالنَّاصِيَةِ, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah will seize him, he will catch him from his forelocks. So forelock, I mean the kids, normally the women do have forelocks, and even the boys as well. I mean, the hair which comes down on your forehead are actually known as forelocks. Someone who does not understand. So Allah is saying he's going to seize him with that. So you know when you pull the hair, you know, I remember some Pakistani parents are very well equipped with the torture of the kids, and they know different kinds of techniques to torture their children. And so for holding the children from their forelocks, I mean, I'm not mentioning you guys, I'm talking about the past when I was a kid. My dad, may Allah give him long life, he had all the skills under the sun, and you know, you name it, belt, any fair like utensils in the house that would just come on your face, not knowing that afterwards there'll be consequences, and consequences in terms of your beauty. I don't mean consequences. And so, but he was very active in that. So. When Allah give him long life, and because of that, well, what I am today, as you see, I sit down over here, I've got listeners. At that time, no one would listen to me, not even my mum and dad as well. I think they do listen to me at times now. So, and then Allah says, نَاسِيَةٍ كَاذِبَةٍ خَاطِعًا, that he's a lying, sinful person, and he will be the one who will be grabbed from his forelocked and dragged. And remember, he's the Fir'aun of the Ummah, he'll be the worst. Rasulullah called him the Pharaoh of this nation. So he's the worst of the people. And that's why Allah is mentioning him. That's why it's important to know the Quran. When we read these surahs, we're so happy our kid is rereading the first surah of Quran. But some of us never knew what these ayahs were, where we don't even understand sometimes. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَا. Remember, Abu Jahl was saying, call, I will call upon my groups, I'll call upon all these leaders, because everyone knows me, you threaten me, to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah is saying to him now, let him call upon his council, his cronies, let him call his cronies, like, let them come. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةِ, Then Allah says, we will call upon the guards of the hellfire. And who are these guards? The angels who are guarding the hellfire are known as Zabaniya. Sanad'u Zabaniya, Allah mentions that Allah be calling these people, or the guards of the hellfire. And then Allah says, Kalla la tuti' wasjud waqtarib. And normally this is the ayah of sujood, but no, we don't have to do sujood. Remember that, okay, there is a difference of opinion when you hear the ayahs of sajda. It's not that all the time, it's sunnah to do sujood, it's not fard to do it. And we know it from Umar ibn Khattab when he read some of the ayahs of sujood at a particular time and he didn't do sujood. So it's from the sunnah to do it. And so this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, advising him, do not obey Abu Jahl or fall in his trap. It's not that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to fall, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reiterating that. And is saying, prostrate to Allah and draw close to Allah, and Allah is your helper. So basically, this was a surah that came down, and Abu Jahl again, Sulaiman was asking, and this is how Allah will humiliate. So these are the people who are humiliated till the day of the judgment. They'll be humiliated. And so their names are being mentioned now. And surahs are coming, one surah Asim ibn Wa'in, one surah for Walid ibn Mughira, one surah for Abu Lahab. These are all tyrants. And now Abu Jahl, you could not be left behind. And see, some of us never knew these ayahs were for Abu Jahl. We spend our lives reading Quran. But these were the ayahs particularly that were mentioned for him. And then, just very quickly, I'll finish off on this. After the words of Quran, Abu Jahl so angry. Now I want to say, he says to his cronies, that to the council, I will kill Muhammad. Next time he's in the Kaaba, I will go with a big stone and I will throw that big stone on his back and he will be finished. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is praying in Kaaba. And he goes with a big stone and his cronies are egging him and he's going past. They're all saying, go, go. You know how today peer pressure, you want to get someone in, you start egging them and they just go with the flow. Everyone's saying, you're mentioning your name and you go and you do things. So that's how he's going. And as soon as he gets close to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gets really terrified, scared, drops the stone, the boulder that he's carrying, and he runs away. And he runs back on his feet to his house. And everyone said, what happened? You were going to kill him. He says, didn't you see there was a big fire of ditch that opened up in the middle of the earth? And it had wings coming out of it. And those wings were looking and they were pointing towards me. When I saw that, I dropped the stone and I ran away. Remember Sanad al-Zabaniya? That Allah said, we'll call upon the hellfire, the angels were the guardians of that. And they have wings, the angels have wings. So they were the ones in that ditch, was the fire that was coming out. That was his place. Allah showed him with the angels. And he ran away. No one saw it, but he saw it. And he got terrified and he ran away. So I'll finish off on that. And inshallah, when we come back, next session is about the conversion of Hamza, how he becomes a Muslim. And that was again giving more power to Islam once he becomes a Muslim. And now very quickly, I don't have much time. Salah is coming very close. It's 47. What time's Azan? Eight. It's 8 o'clock, right?
Eight or nine.
You know what? I'm going to leave these tafsir sessions. I'm actually going to show these books now because I'm not going to bring them back again. So this is a book, and then I'll take questions. This is a book it's actually a very good book in the market. I'll just give you very quick synopsis on these books. So this is a book, Tafsir Ahsan al-Bayan. This is the book that you can, it's in 5 volumes. You can actually get it from anywhere. It's easily available. It's a Dar es Salaam publication. This is a book that you get in Urdu from Makkah when you go. The tafsir book that you get, you know, the big tafsir book, the fat one from Makkah. It's actually, this is the Urdu version of that. Tafsir Ahsan al-Bayan. It's very, in Urdu it's not that big. It's a very, you can just carry in your hands. It's a very small writing. You can actually get a bigger writing as well. And This is a very good book for the kids in the market, Tafsir Jalali. So if I open it, it's got Arabic side by side to it, and it's got English translation. And this English translation is not just word-to-word translation. It's put into sentence form. And it gives you just a very slight idea why that ayah was there. So it completes the sentence. Like, you know, for example, Abu Jahl's mentioned in the translation that we know Abu Jahl. There'll be straight translation. But this book will tell you. And it's actually taught in the Jami'. If you're a student of knowledge, like in my case, in the university where we studied, they actually taught this book, Tafsir Jalalayn. But not in English, obviously, it's in Arabic. But this is the book. Now you've got this one, everyone has it, Tafsir Ibn Kathir. It's available in the market, it's from Darussalam. Very extensive Tafsir, very extensive. And a lot of narrations and everything in there. And also, see, two kinds of Tafsir, I'm not going to mention them now, I don't have time. But next time when I come, I'll give you some Ulum of Quran in the next session, next week. So very quickly, there are two kinds of tafsir, okay? Always remember that. One of the tafsir is tafsir ma'thur, and this is called tafsir bil riwaya. So anything that is mentioned by the pious predecessors. So for example, you've got, you know, the Sahabis, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Quran from Quran and those, which are mentioned, there are sources for it. That's tafsir. And the other one is tafsir, which is tafsir bil ra'i. This is like the modern day scholars when they put these tafsirs together. Now, this is a very good tafsir. It's called the Quran, the Noble Quran, and it's by Muhammad Muhsin Khan and Muhammad Taqiyuddin Hilali. This book has the hadith behind every ayah that is revealed. So actually a very good tafsir. If you want to know why this ayah came down, for example, it will give you the whole hadith as well. What was the... This is called Asbabun Nuzul. In Arabic, the reason for revelation. So this tafsir talks about reasons for revelation. Now this is a very good tafsir. This is very close to my heart. This is tafsir by Allama Abdurrahman Kilani from Pakistan. He's a very big scholar of Ahle Hadith. And he is from, this book is actually published, some of you might be from that region as well. This is in Lahore, you can get it from Anarkali in Lahore. And this is called Taysirul Quran. Taysir, the word means to make Quran easy. It's over four volumes. And Allama Abdurrahman Kilani is a very big scholar of Ahle Hadith. And he did a very, this tafsir is more about riwayah. It's a very very nicely done. You've got the ayah at the top, the translation and the explanation. And then you've got, this is something if you want to just get the gist of Quran, Tafsir Ibn Kathir. It is like just a, where it, what it does, it tells you the gist of the surah. So it just gives you main points of the surah. And everything, what the surah says, what are the main points, and why the surah was revealed and all those. It's over 400 pages. So not a very big read as well. If, before Quran, if you're coming down, you can actually look at this one. And my video is going to be online. So even if you cannot get, write them down, you can actually watch it, pause it. And it gives me likes as well. So anyways. So this is another one. This is Taysirul Rahman Li Bayan Al Quran. This is another big scholar from India. His name is Dr. Muhammad Luqman Selfi. So he is in Saudi, in Mecca. He actually did this tafsir over two volumes. Very easy to read, very simple. Again, going back to the, you know, the, what do you call it? Just the core meaning and to the hadith and the Sahih Riwayah. And these tafsir don't have Israiliyat. Israiliyat are like the narrations from the Bibles and the narration from the Torah, just to compile them together and to give more meaning to the tafsir. This one is another famous scholar from Pakistan, Maulana Abdul Majid Daryabadi. So if you know Deoband School, Darul Uloom, that's where this tafsir is. This is a very simple tafsir, and it's, although I have some reservations for this, You know, when it comes to some of the beliefs of Aqeedah, there might be, but again, if it's a simple read, you want to do it, it's very simple, as you can see. It's got meanings, and then a little explanation, and side by side some points that you can get from the ayah. So they actually mention the points. So every time he translates, on top of the translation, he puts a little footnote, like a little number, and that number will explain the thing. And it's a very brief tafsir, two volumes. So you can actually, it's called Tafsir al-Quran, which is by Maulana Abdul Majid Daryabadi. It's actually in Urdu as well. If you guys cannot read English, this is another one. Now, this one's one of my favorites. This is, if you know, one of the Shaykh al-Hind, Mahmud al-Hassan, from Deoband School, Darul Uloom. He had a student, Maulana Shabir Usmani, who was also part of the freedom movement of Pakistan. And he actually wrote a book. This was from his own teacher. He carried on his message, Shaykh al-Hind Mahmud al-Hassan, his message. And he compiled this book over 8 volumes. It's in Urdu as well, over 3 volumes. And it's called Tafsir-e Usmani. And it's over 8 volumes. So now very quickly, okay. This is Tafhim al-Quran. Personally, not one of my favorites. It's a very political tafsir. But if you guys want to get the gist, this is Maulana Abu al-Ala al-Mawdudi. He's also from our country. He's a tafsir in English and also in Urdu. And personally, not one of my favorites. It's exactly a tafsir like Fi Zilal al-Quran by Sayyid Qutb from Egypt, who was a part of Jamaat al-Islamiyya, Gamal al-Islamiyya, and we have in Pakistan, Jamaat al-Islami. So he was a leader, a very devout man, a great person, don't get me wrong. I'm not in a position, I'm just a normal person, but I'm saying it's very political. It talks about a lot of politics, how to bring changes and things like that. This is the real example of tafsir bil ra'i, like opinionated. This is an opinionated tafsir. Now, my personal best. It's been published now over 10 volumes. My teacher's sheikh's book, Sheikh Muhammad Salih al-Thameen's sheikh, and this is Abdurrahman Nasir al-Sa'di. And this is now, I have this in all different versions. This is in Urdu, it's over 3 volumes. That's in English, it's in 10 volumes. And this is in Arabic, it's only 1 volume. So Arabic's only 1 volume, and Tafsir al-Sa'di, and that's in English, over 10 volumes. And this is in Urdu. Urdu ones are also very well done, but if your Urdu is like me, which only walks and cannot run, then it will be very hard for you to understand this. So now in Urdu, they say, Meri Urdu padal hai. So my Urdu is like that. So meaning I can read it, I can read Urdu, but it's not like really brushed up. So, but a very good book. Look, I would recommend if you know how to read Urdu, only 3 volumes. Okay, now comes the Arabic ones. This is Adawatul Bayan. And this is by Muhammad Al-Amin bin Muhammad Al-Mukhtar Al-Shinkiti. And he is the one who actually wrote one of the best books, if you knew how to read Arabic, which is out there in the market, over 6 volumes, sorry. And the last part, the last 2 volumes were actually completed by his student because he passed away and he was not able to do it. Are one of the best books, free from any opinions or Israeliyat or any of those things. One of the greatest books. This one is Adawatul Bayan. And another one, a very great scholar alive from India, from Hyderabad. He's a very famous scholar. You might have seen his lectures on YouTube. Hafiz Jalaluddin Qasmi. And he wrote a tafsir, which is called Zikrul Lil Alameen. So, you know, the mention of the worlds. And over 3 volumes. If you only have someone you know in India, then you can get it. It's in Urdu. That's my second best. Very easy Urdu to understand. Don't know, probably it's my infringement notice. So, sometimes you have to hide them in these books so no one gets to them. My wife doesn't know about it. Sorry, I shouldn't have said it on the camera. But anyway, this is a very easy to read book. It's a very, very good tafsir. And I would definitely, if you know someone in India, If you have any friends, it's easily available. They can get it, not very expensive, only 1,100. I knew someone from Hyderabad, they gave me as a gift. I'm making dua every day, I read it. This is my bedtime read at the moment. I haven't finished it, but this is, I can tell you, if you get a chance to listen to Hafiz Jalaluddin Qasmi, just listen to him. You will get the kind of knowledge he has. I mean, we're nothing. He is blessed, Allah blessed him. He's from Hyderabad, he lives in India. Now, this is the Durus Tafsir Fil Masjid Al-Haram. This is the scholars of Masjid Al-Haram. They actually made a tafsir from their Durus. And it's in Arabic, over three volumes, a great tafsir. Again, how they explain the Quran, amazing tafsir. Again, if you do know Arabic, and this is an, I do have some more Arabic ones which I did not bring, but these are the ones. This is a very good tafsir, an ancient tafsir, Tafsir Baghawi. A very authentic tafsir, again in Arabic, over five volumes, and very easily done. If you know Arabic language, very easy to read as well. And not very, very, it's a classical Arabic. I mean, if you understand the grammar, then this is a very good tafsir. So, and this is a very, recently done by Harmain. It's called Al-Quran Tadabbur Wal-Amal. So basically this tafsir is made up for four things. It gives you the meaning of the ayah, and then it goes into Al-Amal Bil-Ayat. So what are the good actions you can attain, Amal, the actions from the ayah, and then it goes to Tawjihat. And so basically, you know, the ponder, the things that you can ponder on, and then it goes to the Tadbiriya, well, basically what it is, the pauses, the ayahs which are important, what was the importance of this ayah. There's four things it mentions. Only one volume, again in Arabic, sorry, if you guys don't know. But this is done recently by the scholars of Harmain, very simply done. So Quran is in that small section over there. And then you've got those four things which I mentioned. This is how they highlight it. They bring the meanings. Don't just think even the Arabs know words, every word, what it means. Even to specify, simplify them, they also have the meanings for themselves. Like, you know, for us English, when we speak English, when I said a word, expletives, I want to test some of the people on that. So, Amna, what does expletive mean? No. So, yeah, so expletives is those stars, you know, in the newspaper when someone swears and you put those stars, you don't want to write the whole swear word. So that's expletives. So this is how it, and these are some really good books. And when I come back next time, it's time for Azan now. When I come back, I will, in my next lecture, explain about the two kinds of tafsir in the Ulum. And I will take the best ones of mine, which you already probably got the idea already, but I will take the best ones again, not bring it, but I'll just mention the name because now you've seen every one of them, and inshallah we'll take it from there. If you have any questions, if not, we've only got two more minutes for Azan, and then we can begin inshallah. So any questions, if not, yeah, you got a question.
Have you read all of these books?
Okay, yes, I have read 80% of them. Not all of them in entirety. See, sometimes, remember that, some books are there for reference, and some books are there you read in entirety. So, for example, I am Ahl Hadith. Alright, so you've got different followings in Islam. Some people follow, you know, if you're from Pakistan, you're a Hanafi. So my leniency is always towards the scholars who come from my school of thought. So I trust them more. So those are the ones I've completely read. So, for example, Tafsir al-Sa'di, I've already read it. This book actually came out, the 10 volumes came out only 6 months ago. I've read it in entirety. Because I already had read the Arabic one and it was easy for me to go through it. And Tafsir ibn Kathir is my next project which I'll be doing on my YouTube channel. I'm going to pick up 5 ayahs every day, not with you guys, you can watch it in your own time. And I will do Tafsir ibn Kathir from Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya, from the beginning till the end. And I will, this is called the exhaustive tafsir. I will do one inshallah coming days. We'll start in last 10 minutes, but I'll do an exhaustive tafsir. No matter how long it takes, I will take one page of the Quran and I will focus on most of these books to give you. And I'm not going to be basing it in my opinions. My opinions are only going to come with the lesson to the students as kids like you, but mostly I'm just going to take the opinions. Yeah. So the library, the books I haven't read all of them in entirety. You don't. When it comes to some of the reference books, you keep them for your references. For example, the hadith books, you cannot read. Some people actually have read it, but personally myself, I haven't read all the six books of hadith. I do have all of them, all the volumes in my library, but I haven't read them in entirety. Yes, I've read Bukhari, I've read Muslim, but not all the other ones in entirety. A very good question. And that's why sometimes people start feeling arrogant when they have so many books. When people come around, you ask the question, you got me there by asking that question. Yes?
This is a little irrelevant, but it's pertaining to our existence. So God, Allah, he's an individual, a being of perfection. So what was his need to put us into existence, like to create us?
Okay, very good question. So basically what we need to understand, that was a part and plan of Allah. And in order for us, you know, we all are great. I'll give you an example from your studies point of view. You know, the teacher, and you go to a classroom, everyone's a great kid, everyone's loved by their parents, everyone's close to their parents, teacher can love everyone. But then there is a regressive process in order to find out the individuals who will succeed and also to find out who will actually go further and the ones who are not paying more attention. So the part and parcel of Allah, Allah made us paradise. Allah created that paradise for human beings. No matter who you are, if you look at the jurisprudence, if you even end up in hellfire, you had a place in Jannah. Everyone who was created in this world, Allah had a place for him in Jannah. Everyone. But it's our job now is to work hard and to acquire that place. So, going back to your question, it's not the need of Allah. It's the need that me and you, we have to inspire ourselves. Allah does not need us. See, there's an ayah in Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah does not need us, we need Allah in order to succeed. We have needs. We have families, we have our needs in the dunya, we have the needs of akhirah, we have the needs of barzakh. And in all those needs, we need Allah. And it was not, if Allah did not create anyone, if Allah was on his own, Allah had the angels that would just praise Allah, that will worship Allah, and they're doing it constantly. Did you know that angels actually don't get bored and they do not get tired? They constantly keep on worshiping Allah and they do not stop doing that. And they don't actually have intellect as well. You know how humans are given an intellect? Jinn have given an intellect. What's that intellect? Choice. Allah did not, angels don't have choice. They worship. That's why we inspire by worshipping, we get to another level. And that other level is by going close to Allah and going to close to the commands of Allah. We are in need of Allah. Allah actually didn't need us. And another thing very quickly, I know Azan time's coming and inshallah we'll take this after Salah. I'll talk to you personally as well. But one of the things is you need to understand that when it comes to an atheist as well, the one who says they do not believe in Allah and all these other people, even those people need Allah. You know, when someone falls on his face, if you are just in the ground and you're going through a troubled time, you know, when you're so angry, you know, what's the first thing people say if he's not a Muslim? You know, people say Jesus, right? And Jesus for them is God. So they're calling upon God unknowingly. So they know there's a power, there's a supernatural power. So we are in need of God. God is not in need of us. No matter what we do, we're always going to be in need of God. Remember we said, Allahu Samad. Allah is the one who's sufficient. And we're the ones who need Him in order to suffice our needs. So inshallah, I'll take that question. It requires more explanation. I've just given you a brief one. If we don't get to talk, inshallah, I'll start the next session with this, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفر الله إنه الغفور الرحيم. إن شاء الله someone